following program was provided by an independent producer solely responsible for its content. The opinions expressed do not necessarily represent the views of this station, its staff, board of directors, or underwriters.
Welcome to In Litchfield. I'm your host, John Latcher. You have seen his signs scattered around town. Here's one of them right here. Okay, all over town I've been seeing his signs. Okay. Here's his mom and dad helping out his campaign. Right there. Very nice. You also may have talked to him while he was knocking on your door. And also meeting your dogs. Joe, there's a lot of dogs in Litchfield. I remember going around with a petition warrant article.
Yes.
Did you have a lot of treats in your pocket to these animals or what?
It depends. it depends. Some houses I would kindly pass on, if I, depending on the dog. No treats. But that's a good advice for
right.
me.
Now, I'm just guessing here, okay, because you're a Democrat, right? Mm-hmm. Now, were there more Democratic dogs out there than Republican, Joe?
I would say a nice 50-50 split.
50-50 yeah. split. Oh, what yeah. a guy. I thought for sure that Joe would say, you know, it's 75-25. Democrat, right? But hey, we have an honest guy here. Right?
I didn't ask the dogs personally.
The first time on the show, we have an honest guy. Right? Okay. My guest today is Joe Stanish Burke. He said we can call him Joe, right, Joe?
That's right, yep. Right.
Okay.
Please.
And as I said before, you're a Democrat running for state representative, Hillsborough, mm-hmm. District 14, which represents Litchfield,
yep.
along with another Democratic challenger mm-hmm. Candidate, Mahendra Bakshi.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, all right. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me.
All right. So you are a marketing manager, huh? Tell us a little bit about that, Joe.
Yeah, I've been in the marketing industry now for over 10 years, mm-hmm. and I've been with Tupelo Music Hall in Derry.
Oh, Tupelo Music?
For
nice
a couple
facility.
Years now.
Nice facility.
Yeah, yeah nice facility, yeah. Great music. Mm-hmm. It's a dream job, and mm-hmm. I absolutely adore the position.
Mm-hmm. Now, I saw, Joe, previously that Christopher Cross was there.
That's right.
Hall & Oates, I mean... I was like the wife, let's go. I mean, let's sit and sleep over in the parking lot to get a ticket to this. I mean, my favorite is Barry Manilow. I love Barry Manilow, but I like Christopher Cross too. I just love that music. How about you? What kind of music do you like, Joe?
All over the place. I primarily listen to pop, folk, light rock. Mm-hmm. R&B, that's kind of my jam, but I mean, I used to play in a band with my family, an Irish band with my family, so of course I know a lot of the Irish music and a lot of the kind of classic sing-alongs that you would sing at a bar.
Great. Any hobbies that you have, Joe, that you can tell our viewers?
Yeah, I mean, I have two kids right now, so a lot mm-hmm. of the free time that I have is kind of with them, when I am able to get some free time for some hobbies, I grew up playing volleyball, so volleyball and tennis. I made a joke about it. I actually, when I was 12, I hit a hole in one.
Really?
And then I don't have the patience for the game, and I just made a joke that after that I was going to retire from golf. But it was really because I just didn't. It right. wasn't for me. Yeah.
I just say that I can play golf, too, yeah. okay, but I really can't.
Yeah.
All right, let's get to work on your campaign. That's the reason why you're here.
Yeah.
I assume you have the proud endorsement of the National Education Association, one of the largest union educators in New Hampshire.
That's right. Yeah.
As well as the American Federation of Teachers mm-hmm. and the LGBTQ Victory Fund.
That's right, yep.
here's a picture of that you've taken at the dump with veteran state senator Donna Soucy. He's going to put that up there like that.
Yep.
Has Donna given you any advice, Joe, about how to run a campaign? She's a veteran, you know.
She's
very strong, especially in Manchester, and even here in Litchfield, she's pretty strong.
She is, yeah. With being at the polls with her, or at the transfer station with her 2 weekends in a row, mm-hmm. it was clear that a lot of people liked her and enjoyed speaking with her. So, yeah, it's actually been a pleasure. I saw her she joined me at the polls for primary day. Mm-hmm. And then the 2 weekends in a row at the transfer station. So yeah, it's been nice kind of picking her brain about various things because as a first-time candidate, I have a lot of questions and she's the perfect person to talk to.
Great, great. Now, most experts say, Joe, that a campaign must go negative to win. Do you believe that? Or from what I've seen, you've been, you know, really pretty clean candidate as far as that's concerned. Am I right?
Yeah, correct. Yeah, I don't, I made it a promise that I don't like the vitriol and a lot of the combativeness of politics. And mm-hmm. so as a first-time candidate, I really wanted to run a campaign that ran on positivity, empathy, and compassion. And so I hope kind of moving from now until Election Day, I hope that, you know, I'll continue that. And I hope that's, you know, voters find that very responsive.
Mm-hmm. Now, you say that you're new to politics, mm-hmm. politics, but I would tend to differ with you looking over your website,
okay.
Joe, okay? Here is the opening of your website right here. You're with your husband and two young children.
That's right.
Joe, I'll tell you right now, those kids grow up so fast. I'm telling you, pretty soon you're going to be sitting on the sidelines watching their soccer games like I used to, right? Yeah. And then, you know what I would do, Joe? I'd be in the middle of painting, right? And then I'd have to put the paintbrush in the freezer, okay? Because that's where it would stay good mm-hmm. for when I had the chance to paint again, right?
Yeah.
Then I'd have to go down to the soccer game to watch my son, right? I mean, that's what life is like, Joe. Are you looking forward to that or what?
Yeah. I love the more active phase of kids. You know, I have a 3-year-old and 1-year-old, and mm-hmm. once that 1-year-old is, you know, starts speaking more and becoming a lot more independent, that's when I'll really start enjoying a lot of the time. But yeah, they're great kids, and I absolutely love it.
Soccer is very big in this town, Joe.
It is.
Especially in the schools. Wow, I tell you, the girls' soccer team. Oh my boy, I'll tell you.
Yeah, we got my 3-year-old playing in the morning Saturday league over mm-hmm. at GMS. Mm-hmm. We're trying to get him involved in sports early, and he's not loving it, but he's there. So it's fine. Yeah, we'll see how interested he is.
Now, speaking of your website, how does one get to your website? What's the address? How do they get to it?
We're going to
put it on the screen periodically so people can see it throughout the show. So
okay, great.
Just for those at home.
Yeah, you can visit nhrepjoe, so nhrepjoe.com, and mm-hmm. they can find my website and information there.
Very good. Very good. Now, you say that you encourage the town to elect a young leader, mm-hmm. okay? What's wrong with old and experienced, Joe, which we have presently? Can you tell our viewers at home?
Yeah, I don't think there's anything wrong with old and experienced, but I do think New Hampshire is a very interesting state where, as many people know, state representatives don't make barely any money. It's $100, I think, a year.
And they pay tolls, too.
They pay
whippy, you know?
Yeah, the luxury.
Speaking of that, Joe, do you think that state reps should get more than $100, or do you think it's just kind of a public service duty?
Yeah, I think, like, in principle, I think it's a very honorable thing to say, here's $100, you should do it out of the kindness of your heart, give mm-hmm. back to the state, your community. But when you really look at it, it disenfranchises a lot of people. So a lot of New Hampshire kind of, if you are independently wealthy or you are retired, you can run for state office. If you are neither of those things, which I am not, it makes it more difficult to run for office.
So money is it in politics.
Yeah. So the average age of the House of Representatives in the state house is 61 years old. I don't think that's very reflective of people in my demographic and people in their 40s and 50s. So, mm-hmm. You know, over time, I would like to see that change a little bit. I don't know what that answer is, but I would like to see more young people become involved in politics.
Great. Another thing that you talk about is the difference between your campaign and the current incumbents. Mm-hmm. Is that your campaign fosters inclusivity, empathy, and practical ideas. Can you give us a few examples, Joe?
Yeah, so part of the reason why, and I apologize, this is going to be a question coming up soon, but like part of the reason why I decided to run for office this year was because there was a lot of anti-LGBTQ bills that our current incumbents either sponsored or voted in favor for.
Okay.
Some of those were included like reinstating conversion therapy, banning trans kids from playing sports, and outing kids in schools when they weren't ready. So those issues affected me personally as a member of the LGBTQ community.
Right.
And so I don't think those kind of values of attacking a community or taking rights away, say women and reproductive rights.
Yeah.
I think leaders need to lead with empathy. There's a lot bigger issues in New Hampshire we need to focus on. And I think that's where our time is best spent.
Okay. On your website, you also say that people in Litchfield need a representative that listens more than talks.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel that the representatives representing Litchfield currently have put a deaf ear on its constituents?
I don't know if I would say that. I don't know either of them too personally, so I wouldn't go out and say that. But I will say that I know from experience and other politicians that when you hold office for a prolonged period of time, sometimes you can tend to lose the connection that you have with community and people,
right.
Just being kind of removed from the community and being in the House of Representatives for too long.
Mm-hmm. What if you want to, you don't. If you want to answer this question, fine. If you don't, what grade would you give them, A through F?
Yeah, I don't feel comfortable giving them a grade, but I will say, yeah, just based on you know, how the different things that New Hampshire's experiencing with high property taxes, high utility bills, some assaults on LGBTQ rights, reproductive rights, education, I would say that I wouldn't be the best grade, but I'm not going to go ahead and give it a grade.
Mm-hmm. Most people believe in term limits.
Mm-hmm.
My opinion is that people should not make a career out of public service.
Yeah. Yep.
Do you feel the same way, Joe? Or
I do. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I again, like going back to, I feel when someone holds office for a prolonged period of time, I do think you begin to lose touch with the reality and the real issues that affect communities. And so I fully support term limits.
Now, do you know what my next question is going to be, Joe? Do you think that Jeanne Shaheen should say, well, she's a Democrat, she's been there forever. Do you think that she should consider maybe giving somebody else a chance?
I'm always in favor. I'm not going to say that, but I am in favor of, you know, younger people stepping up in the role of politics and taking on bigger roles. I don't have any personal vendetta against her. I think she's a great representative for New Hampshire, but yeah.
Okay. What if you should lose this race, Joe? Will you take a look at local politics, like the Board of Selectmen, or?
Yeah, it's an option. I won't turn away from it. I would like to find definitely more ways to get involved with the community. Different things that I've kind of been brainstorming is running for a more local office for our town, even maybe trying to get into substitute teaching, volunteering. So yeah, there are a bunch of different ways that I'm looking to kind of make an impact there if it doesn't work out for me in November.
Great. Now, the opposite of the question, what if you should win this race?
Mm-hmm.
Have you thought of any committees of interest to you?
So like as a father of two kids, obviously the Children and Family Law Committee is of interest to me.
Mm-hmm.
I have the endorsement of, as you mentioned earlier, AFT and NEA.
Yep.
So the Education Committee is important. And Litchfield is like a rural agriculture community. I think it'd be important for someone from our town to be on, you know, one of the conservation, there's a few conservation, environmental, yeah, agricultural committees. So right. I think any of those would be good fits.
Mm-hmm. Now, what is the one thing that you would change in the Republican Party if you had the ability to change it?
Mm-hmm.
And flip that around again, what would you do for your own change for in your own party, the Democratic Party, if you had the ability to change it?
That's a great question. For Republicans, I know it's like I grew up in a house that voted Republican from time to time. My family was independent, so we would vote Democrat, we would vote Republican, depending on the candidate. But the Republican Party today is not the same Republican Party that it was when I was younger.
Well, what has changed, do you think?
So I think just a lot of the the platform. I don't think there's been a lot of growth with the Republican Party. I think there's been a lot of stepping back, back in time. And I think the best way for parties to grow and leaders to grow is to progress as a society and encourage progress as communities. And so that's one thing I would change for the Republican Party. And then for Democrats, the thing I would change is just messaging. I think Democrats, in general, struggle with getting messaging out.
Yeah.
And Republicans usually tend to do a little bit better job about branding how they message things. And Democrats try to put a little bit too much here, too much there, and then it kind of falls on deaf ears. So,
what do you think nationally this time around with the midterm elections? Do you think the Democrats are going to do well, or do you think the Republicans are going to, don't you know?
I don't know, and I'm not in the game of predictions, but right. I would hope that based on the current state of things, with women's reproductive rights, I hope that there's a big turnout for Democrats just mm-hmm. to protect those across the country.
Great, we're going to take our first commercial break, and I'll be back with Joe Standish Burke. He's a candidate for state representative for District 14, which represents Litchfield. And we'll do that right after this, so stay with us.
I just remembered it's election day. Are you going to vote?
I don't know. I don't think I'll have time today.
Millions of eligible voters in America never make it to the polls or even register to vote. When you don't vote, you're letting other people make decisions for you and pick the things your taxes will pay for. Voting is more than a civic duty. It gives you a voice about the priorities and the future of your community and our nation. Voting gives you a seat at the table.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back to In Litchfield. I'm your host, John Latcher, with my guest, Joe Standish Burke. He's running for state representative in District 14, which represents Litchfield. All right, Joe. As we're moving on here.
Mm-hmm.
Legalizing marijuana. Some have called the state of New Hampshire an island in New England, meaning the states around us support the legalization of mm-hmm. marijuana. Where are you on the legalization of marijuana here in New Hampshire?
Yeah, I think the legalization of cannabis, I'm in favor of it. I think it can open up a bunch of doors for New Hampshire where we're experiencing higher property taxes because our state relies too heavily on local property taxes. Right. And so I think legalizing cannabis is a good gateway for us to tax those sales, have the state manage, grow, and sell the product, mm-hmm. Tax the sales of cannabis, and divert a lot of those funds to education so we can take that burden off of local property owners. Mm-hmm. Right now, as we're seeing, I believe the union leader did a report on it earlier, but we're losing millions and millions of dollars because people, like you said, it's an island in New England. People right. can go to Vermont, people can go to Maine, people can go to Massachusetts.
Right. Right.
And so New Hampshire's losing it out on all this revenue that we could use to benefit so many things across the state.
What do you think the rift is? What do you think behind the scenes that we're not doing that? Is it the Republican establishment, or what do you think?
No, I know that like our current incumbents, I think they're split 50-50 based on their voting record about where they stand on this issue.
Mm-hmm.
So I do know that there are some Republican people who at least are in favor to discussing it.
Yeah.
So I know a vast majority of Democrats are in favor of doing this. So I think it's kind of getting enough Republicans on board to make it happen, to mm-hmm. make it a reality.
Now in New Hampshire, from what I understand, is that they allow prescribed medical marijuana. Is that correct in the state of New Hampshire?
I'm honestly not sure about that. I know recreationally it is obviously illegal, mm-hmm. But I don't know where medical marijuana stands.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Same-sex marriage has been legal in New Hampshire since 2010.
Mm-hmm.
Republican Governor Chris Sununu signed a bill which allowed unmarried couples, both gay and straight, to adopt children. A New Hampshire poll said that 73% support same-sex marriage mm-hmm. and around 22% oppose.
Yep.
6 in 10 LGBTQ students feel that they are unsafe going to school. You are a member of the LGBTQ community. Mm-hmm. How do you think the LGBTQ community has been received here in New Hampshire? And do you feel more work has to be done?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's always more room for improvement in making, you know, our most vulnerable population, youth, and add on the factor that they're LGBTQ. Mm-hmm. I think there's a lot more that New Hampshire can do to provide safe spaces for those kids. Mm-hmm. A lot of the bills that have been tried to get passed in the past few years have been alarming, trying to out students in school, trying to say you're trans so you cannot play a sport. Right. And I think there's a lot of things that New Hampshire is doing right, but I think there's a lot of people who are getting in the way and trying to make it set back and make it even tougher for these kids to just exist as themselves. Yeah. And in the LGBTQ community, we see alarming rates of, sadly, but suicide in youth. And so trying to pass these laws that hurt these kids is not where New Hampshire values stand based on how everyone feels about acceptance. And so I do think there's always room for improvement.
Mm-hmm. What can we do locally? I know what your thoughts about the state level, but what can we do locally to help the students at these schools?
Yeah, I just...
Can we do anything?
Yeah, of course.
We can do something, right?
Yeah, there's a ton of nonprofits in New Hampshire that are doing a lot of work. Gleason, who I volunteered with before, they do a lot of... they focus on education and students and providing safe places for them and making sure teachers are adequately prepared to... talk to kids who are LGBTQ. I think just making sure that kids feel safe, providing safe environments, making sure teachers are have the training to talk with students. I know in Massachusetts, one person I spoke with while canvassing, she's a teacher in Massachusetts, but she lives in Litchfield, and she was talking about they receive training yearly about LGBTQ students. And I don't know if that's happening in our state. It might be, but that's just one thing that we can do to just make the kids feel safe.
Yeah, these kids are under a lot of pressure. I mean, it affects their schooling and everything. I look at it as like kind of like a bullying kind of thing, where the kid's afraid to go to school, and you know, it's a very sad situation.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, and I think that's part of training teachers to be prepared to handle those situations. Bullying. I've heard about it from, again, people canvassing that bullying's an issue at our schools.
Yeah.
And so, anything that we can do to just break the stigma of kids and LGBTQ kids, I think is just a nice step in the direction. And that comes with parents talking to their kids at home and just making them aware that these kids exist, and teachers. So,
do you think there should be, as you mentioned, teachers and everything, do you think there should be something in the classrooms to discuss,
As far as like classrooms go, I think it's providing like LGBTQ clubs to just make the kids feel like they can be a part of something, I think is a helpful discussion. Mm-hmm. And of course, like as the kids get older in high school, I don't see why LGBTQ history and acknowledging that a lot of people who have contributed to historical things in society have been LGBTQ people, and acknowledging that, and that's part of how you can break that stigma, is just making people aware that these people exist.
Okay. What was your reaction this past June, Joe, when during the LGBTQ Pride Month, when a patron asked the book display be removed at the Aaron Cutler Library? There's a picture of it right there with no books on it.
Yeah.
He checked out all 15 books. Now, Joe, when I went to the library, they said 2 books and that's it, okay? If you took 3 books, all right, the librarian would, like, follow you out the door to your car and say, you can only take 2 books. First of all, I want to know how this guy took out 15 books, unless he had some of his friends do it. That's the only thing I can think of. So the display was empty. Now, a lot of residents demanded that this display be restored. Do you think that was a very unfortunate incident and a mistake by the library to allow those books to even go out?
I think it was sad and unfortunate to see that happen in town. A lot of times myself and my family don't feel safe. And it was one of the reservations that my husband had of even me entering this race is just because we want to live ourselves and we don't want to put a target on us. So when this happened at the library, I was very disappointed, but I was happy to see there was a light at the end of this, where I was happy to see the amount of people who came out in support afterwards was very, very encouraging to see people show up and...
They knew that that was wrong.
Correct. And then even across town, we saw a bunch of people put up pride flags, and just seeing that kind of reaction to it just gave me a lot of more hope for our town. I enjoyed that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's talk about abortion. You're obviously a pro-choice candidate.
Yeah.
So Litchfield, the current representatives of Litchfield, you have said that have scored 0% from Planned Parenthood.
Mm-hmm.
Democratic Congressman Chris Pappas warns that the GOP wants government, not women, to dictate abortion decisions. Do you agree?
Yeah, I mean, we've seen firsthand from even one of the Republicans running for Senate even mentioned that it's a, I think this came out a week or two ago, he even said it's a Congress, or it's a man's job to dictate these things. And that's not the case. I think men should have, stay out of this, government should stay out of this and leave it up to the women completely. Mm-hmm. I was sad to see that our incumbents were part of the reason why the 24-week abortion ban passed recently. And
speaking of the 24 weeks, one of your opponents was in favor to prohibit abortion after 24 weeks. And the other one went a step further and said up to 20 weeks. So.
And they even voted for a bill to go to the floor for a vote from everyone that would have banned it at 6 weeks.
Right.
And so there was even discussion of that, which is concerning.
Yeah, concerning, definitely concerning. What was your feelings the Roe versus Wade being overturned and leaving it up to the states to decide? What that was really.
Yeah, it was
historical.
It was big news. I mean, that was part of the reason that kind of fueled my interest in running as well. Of course, when it comes down to human rights, reproductive rights are part of human rights, and those are very important to me. And so when we leave those things up to a state, it becomes a very inequitable law. When we say, because you live in this state, you have these rights, but if you move 20 miles to the west and you're in that state, you now, I don't like how those...
It was a frenzy the minute it was overturned.
Yeah, I think when it comes down to human rights, we should have a policy that blankets the entire country to make it more equitable and fair for everyone, regardless of where you live. You should have the same access to the same healthcare rights, reproductive rights, LGBTQ rights. Those should all be the same across our country.
Okay. So in other words, government stay out of the women's business, correct?
Correct, yes. Yep, absolutely.
Okay.
Yep.
Do you have anything to add with that for the abortions that you'd like to talk to the viewers about that I didn't mention, or anything that you'd like to?
Yeah, I would just say that not much to add. I think that was pretty much all I had to say. But I do think it's important that when people go to the polls in on November that you consider who your representatives are and how they voted in the past for these issues that affect so many people across the state.
Great. Education. As I said previously, you would like to see more funding for teachers in schools.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The state of New Hampshire is 16% below the national average for state funding for public education.
Yeah.
What are they doing with our lottery money, Joe? Huh?
That's good.
All you people out there in Concord, if you're watching us here, okay, what are you doing with all that lottery money? Huh?
Yeah, we need to see some receipts, right? I think, I was group that was doing a lot of work for in regards to property taxes and education and making that more equitable too. They were saying that it's New Hampshire actually ranks, it might be 16% below the national average, but it's also 49th or 50th in the country as far as state funding.
Okay.
And so when you do that, it makes the entire state unequitable in how we fund things, because just because you live in this town, you pay more for schools. Because you live in this town, you don't have to pay as much for schools.
Right.
And if we can legalize cannabis and have the state control it and impose a tax on it for us to create some revenue, and we can alleviate a lot of these issues for schools, property taxes.
Now they're thinking about building a new elementary school in Litchfield, and they're going to be really wanting some big building aid. How would Joe do that if you win this race?
Well, of course, before the recent events in town, I was absolutely for building a new elementary school. Mm-hmm. I think it was based on the information that I was reading. It just was more a better decision financially and just for the town itself, just
then
for the
renovate,
long run.
Yeah.
And so, of course, I was for that. And then in the light of recent events, I would say, based on how our budget is now, I would kind of pull back on those remarks, and I would like us to kind of see how things go before we invest in anything too big.
Okay. Do you think better classrooms help with education? They obviously do. I mean,
yeah,
lighting and
Bigger classrooms, more classrooms. You know, if someone needs special services, they shouldn't have to do it out in the hallway. You know, there should be, you know, different classrooms and different resources, different learning materials, and fire drills that work, sprinkler systems that work, septic, systems that work. So
you think that we can do better? Is that what you're thinking? Elementary school?
I think everyone would agree with that statement one way or another, whether you agree with renovating it completely or building new. I think that sentiment's felt by everyone.
Now, I heard the price tag, it was around $26 million, and then it went up to like $35 million at the last time I heard it. Is that a lot of money for taxpayers, Joe?
It is, yes. Yep, it is. Yeah, and like I said, it's... I know that there were like capital funds that they had to do the project, but of course now, again, with the light of how things have been handled, I'm not for a school being built right now at this moment.
Great. New Hampshire has the fourth highest property taxes, the town of Claremont being the highest. You said you spoke to a voter who moved out of Litchfield
who
could no longer afford their property taxes.
Yes.
As you know, Joe, most property taxes go to educating our students.
Mm-hmm.
Are you kind of handcuffed on the issue of property taxes? On one hand, you want to help the property taxpayer, but on the other hand, you're for more funding for teachers and schools, as well as the endorsement of the NEA.
Yeah.
What do you do on that one, Joe?
Yeah, it's just being
kind of between a rock and a hard place, I think, on what I'm saying.
Yeah, and I understand that, and I think it's important for New Hampshire to be creative about how we're a state that doesn't have an income tax, and I support not having an income tax.
Mm-hmm.
But that leaves us, we need to be creative about how we address certain issues, and with property taxes, again, I think we can make a huge dent if we find a new ways to help assist us in raising money for public education. And again, I think if we can legalize cannabis and do that, I think it can, you know, kill two birds with one stone. I think it's a very practical idea that a lot of states have done around us. Colorado has done it successfully. So it can be done. And I would like to kind of see that done. Yeah.
Okay. People are struggling to pay the utility bills.
Yeah.
You said you will seek solutions.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any to offer us now, Joe?
Yeah, part of what New Hampshire needs to do is year after year, over the past few years, we've seen bills brought to the floor for a vote that would bring more renewable energies into New Hampshire.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, I understand that that's not the end-all solution. We can't just be, it takes time to get there. But what we've done for ourselves in New Hampshire is by not even addressing it or attempting to put more effort into it, as a lot of states around us have done, is we become too reliant on fossil fuels.
Yeah.
And what we're seeing right now is with circumstances around the world affecting prices is the price of oil is skyrocketing. And so we have kind of, you know, put our foot in our mouth, and now we're sitting here being like, our utilities are too high. Well, it's because we're reliant on fossil fuels, and that the market right now is exploding with those prices. So if we expanded our energy portfolio and we opened our doors to more solar, more wind, I believe that we wouldn't be in this situation, because a lot of the surrounding states like us, everyone's kind of seen utility prices increase, but no one's seen them like New Hampshire is, 120% increase for a lot of people.
Right.
That's a solely New Hampshire issue right now. That's not an every state thing. And so if we can open our doors to renewables, I think we would be in a better place where we are now.
Mm-hmm. Should we have windmills, Joe, on the coast, or what should we do?
I'm open for those discussions. I think we need to be open to everything right now if we can just provide any sort of relief for people in Litchfield and New Hampshire.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. One thing that a person really is concerned about, you know, solar panels and all that, is the cost. Mm-hmm. It's very, very expensive, especially for a house, you know, putting
on
the roof and everything. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and it's, like I said, right now, it's not, I don't think it's, you know, go all renewables right now. I don't think it's a solution. Yeah. It's still...
I mean, long-term.
Long-term, it's great.
Long-term, yeah.
It is great, but, you know, we're not there as a society yet where we can do it for cost-effectively right now. So I think it does take time to get there, but we need to be starting the process now before it's too late.
Okay. The economy, the national inflation rate is around 8% right now, nationally. Unemployment rate here in New Hampshire is around 2%. 2%. Mm-hmm. You are in favor of raising the minimum wage, which is at $7.25 per hour.
Yep.
Can you tell our viewers the number you would raise it to? But the problem is, Joe, is that only 1% of the workforce in New Hampshire is getting $7.25 an hour, the minimum wage. So why would you raise it, Joe? And wouldn't that hurt small businesses in the state by having higher payroll costs while paying more for inventory?
No, not necessarily. I mean, if we...
Help me out here.
Yeah, I mean, if first of all, we need, regardless of, even if it's 1%, I don't know if that's true, but even if it is 1%, that's still 1% that we, that are making a wage that's not dignifying nor livable. Mm-hmm. And that should be 0%. No matter what your job is, no matter what you do, you should be able to have a dignifying, livable wage. Mm-hmm. So I don't know what that number looks like, but it's not $7.25. Mm-hmm. That's a very antiquated, outdated number, and it's not reflective of today's time. If you make that much money, you can't buy a house in New Hampshire. The prices in Litchfield are...
You couldn't even live in the street, Joe, I don't think, for $7.25.
Correct, exactly. And I think we need to... We need to, you know, talk about that more. And I think we need to bring that to the light, because that's, even if it's 1%, if that is the correct number and true, that's still not justifiable. Mm-hmm. We need to raise that to make it a much more dignifying wage. And aside from that, too, it's we need to do a better job about retaining and recruiting our workforce. So when neighboring states are paying much more for the same type of job, like I said, I met a teacher who works in Massachusetts because in New Hampshire, she wouldn't be able to afford to live here. Mm-hmm. We need to do a better job to keep those people in New Hampshire. We have people who are leaving high school, going out of state because they're going to go to school for cheaper and find better paying jobs in those states than New Hampshire. And while our state kind of ages, we need to be cognizant of the fact that we need to do more to keep the kids in state and keep our workforce here. And passing bills that protect human rights and raising the minimum wage and raising wages for everyone to make it more competitive in New England is the good starting point to do that.
Now, what about the effect on small business, Joe, with raising that? I mean,
So some states that have...
If you have a mom and pop store and you want to hire somebody...
I mean, the more you pay someone more money, they spend more money back in the economy. Mm-hmm. So a lot of states that have raised the minimum wage for small businesses. I work for a small business. I know firsthand, but like if you raise a minimum wage, that money goes back into the economy and helps other small businesses. So
And we need definitely small businesses. It's the lifeblood of this country.
Absolutely.
Correct?
100%. Yep. Okay, absolutely.
All right, we're going to take another commercial break, and I'll be back with State Representative, he's running for state representative. Right. Help me out here.
Hopefully again.
Joe Stanich in District 14, which represents Litchfield. And we'll be back right after this, so stay with us. Hi, everyone. Welcome back to Litchfield. I'm your host, John Latcher. You can wave too, Joe. Wave.
Hi, everyone.
This is what I do all the time on this show.
Here's my hands. Yeah.
I asked everybody, forget it. All I do is wave, okay? I might have maybe one friend out there. I don't know. Let's see. All right, Joe. Voting. We all going to hopefully go to Campbell High School. That means right. You out there, okay? November 8th, 7 to 7, Campbell High School. You want to pass legislation that automatically registered eligible voters mm-hmm. when they reach the age of 18.
Yeah.
22 states now have it, which also includes Maine, Vermont, Mass, mm-hmm. and Rhode Island. Here we go with the island again,
yep.
Joe, okay?
Why
not New Hampshire, Joe? What's the reasoning behind that? Do we know?
That's a great question. I mean, anytime that we can increase our civic duty for everyone in the state, I think it's a no-brainer decision. Mm-hmm. I don't know how this bill, if it has ever been brought to the floor or even debated on, but I do think it's crucial that we get young people involved and take the hard work of them. It shouldn't be that hard to register. We should make registering to vote as easy and simple as possible.
Yeah, you want to make it as easy as possible.
Yep,
definitely,
that's right.
Definitely. Yeah, I think it's a great idea.
Yeah.
Actually, great. Seeing that you should win, Joe, mm-hmm. win this race, do you have a problem working with a Republican for the benefit of Litchfield?
No, not at all. And if I do win and the Republican wins the other seats, I will happily work with them to, you know, bring a lot of positive change for Litchfield if they're open to working with me.
Okay. Now, I said previously in the show, earlier in the show, that you were knocking on doors mm-hmm. in Litchfield.
Yeah.
What's the number one issue people are talking to you about, Joe? Can you share that with our viewers?
Yeah, I would say there's three big issues that I've, when I'm knocking doors. One is education, of course. Mm-hmm.
What are they telling you?
I've met a lot of teachers, surprisingly amount of teachers. I don't know if mm-hmm. I just accidentally hit all of them on my list or not, but
and what are they saying?
They're looking for someone who's will back education, support public education. Okay. One of the biggest things that they brought out is the recent voucher program that New Hampshire has started, which is costing millions and millions of dollars. And this year we've only seen 27% of the people who have taken advantage of that voucher program actually came from public schools to use the voucher program to go to a private school. Mm-hmm. So the difference there, it's a lot of people who are taking advantage of this program were not in public schools to begin with. So we're losing a lot of money that should be going to public schools for these people who have already been using it for private school. So mm-hmm. That's been a big issue for voters, as well as reproductive rights and abortion rights. Okay. That's been a big thing. And of course, like everyone's affected, the property taxes and utility bills.
Yeah. What do you think, Joe, is the biggest issue facing Litchfield now and in the future? What do you think?
I'll give you two answers, because I don't know how to rank them, but I will definitely say the rising cost. I think Litchfield is a small rural town, so you know, anytime that you have these outrageous spending, it's going to hurt a lot of families, and so it's hurting my family, as I'm sure it's hurting everyone's, and so that's a big issue. And the other one I think that we need to be focusing on more is the water contamination.
Yes. Do you think that we got the short end of the stick on St. Gobain on that issue, or do you think state representatives should have done a little bit more, or what do you think about that?
Yeah, I mean, especially the more and more that we find out about how harmful the contaminants that are in our water system are, like more stuff's coming out every day, yes, I think we should have been a little bit more aggressive in mm-hmm. holding them accountable for things that they did, especially, I believe, there's even a few reports that they might have known what they were doing, and I would have liked to see that held a bit more accountable. But yeah, I mean, I think we need to do more to provide safe drinking sources, filters, for families, and I think that's a big issue that's affecting a lot of people with wells in town.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they still have a pallet of water, Joe, next door in the old fire station over here.
Yeah.
That people are still on bottled water even years after the after the incident.
Yeah, I'm on city water, but I still refuse to drink out of the tap just because I'm just not sure where things stand as far as the safety of the water. So yeah, I think that's a big issue affecting a lot of families in New Hampshire.
What can we do, Joe, about the price of water in this town? I mean, Penichuk is like, you know, I pay over $100 a month for water,
Joe. Yeah. Yep.
And it really isn't the best quality water.
Yeah, right? I know, that's what I'm saying.
Some of the selectmen in town have been talking about getting our own tank and all this other stuff. I'm like, what? Yeah, millions and millions of dollars.
Yeah.
Well, what do you think as far as, like, if say you were put on your state representative hat again, would you go to Penichuk and try to have some kind of discussion with them about the complaints in Litchfield?
Yeah, I want to review more what
that's another big problem in this town too.
Yeah, of course, and I'd want to review what has already been brought to Penichuk before I go and try to discuss further with them. I'm sure there's a lot of things that state reps across the state have done to have those conversations. It is a bit frustrating as someone who lives in Litchfield when we see neighboring towns have lower prices for the usage of water. It's a bit irritating and frustrating, especially as, like I've said before numerous times now, but as other things have skyrocketed in price, so it's just another thing to hit people across Litchfield with.
Now, to put on your state representative hat again, all right, what do you think about the, as far as, do you think that, I would like to see state representatives, like, talk to our schools more, talk to our selectmen more, going to meetings, you know, periodically, bi-monthly or monthly or whatever, to update us what's going on with Concord. Would you be willing to do that? Or?
Yeah, I think that's part of the responsibility is once you become a state representative for the town, you need to remain engaged with the town. So that means talking with the people who voted for you, the people who didn't vote for you, talking with the people who hold the elected office positions in town, the school board, superintendent. I think those are all valid conversations that need to be had to make sure that what I would then bring back to Concord with me is reflective of what the town wants.
Right. I know that you're running for state rep now, Joe, but are you going to ask, like, we'll go back to what we said before about term limits and everything. Yeah. Are you going to go back to Donna Susie and tell her, look, I want her to take your seat?
No. And I think my if my husband's watching this, I'm sure he's shaking his head now, too. No, absolutely not. That won't be the case.
Want to get you in trouble now.
Yeah, no, I have, I'm very happy with my full-time job as a marketing manager at Tupelo Music Hall. I'm just doing this get in there and stop a lot of rights that are being taken away from people and as well as fix a lot of issues that I think are being ignored. And so I kind of want to get in there, kind of try to make a difference and see what I can do. But no, I have no desire to really take this any step further than a state representative.
Okay. What are some of the real world issues that you speak of that pose a threat to towns, families, schools, and small businesses across New Hampshire?
Yeah, I think the part you're mentioning is, I believe on my website, I mentioned the fact that I think a lot of Republicans, including some of our incumbents, are focusing too much on non-issues that target. It's a lot of platform of anti-this, anti-that, but there's not a lot of legwork being done to make progress on anything else. And so, so as we see record-setting property taxes, utility bills, as we see a school system that's funded inequitably, and that now there's a voucher program that's even taking more money away from it. We're seeing a lot of these issues that I believe are real issues that are affecting things in our daily lives. And I don't think spending our time taking away reproductive rights from women or taking away LGBTQ rights from kids and families in town, I don't think that's very conducive to what we need to be doing. I think we need to reshift a lot of our focus on issues that are affecting families and individuals across our town and state.
Now we're taping on the 14th of October. What's Joe going to do between now and Election Day?
Well, I will be out canvassing every weekend, and I try to get out now that we're in October and less than a month away. I try to get out once during the week, knocking doors. So I'll be doing that as much as I can.
From what I saw on your website, Jim, I'm just not making this up. Okay. You go to these homes while there's football on?
No, actually, no, nope, nope. Sunday, I go on Saturday. So college football, maybe. I go on Saturdays.
College football, maybe.
So sometimes I've been going on Saturdays a bunch. But if I go on Sundays, I try to stop before the first game, unless the unless the game's taking place in, like, England somewhere, and I can't control that. The game's at 8 a.m.
Now, I don't care if you're a Democrat or Republican. If you come on my, you come to my house while the Patriots are playing, okay? I'm gonna throw you right out of my yard, all right?
Yeah, that won't be happening. I promise I will not interfere with the Patriots for sure. So
okay,
yeah,
all right. All right. So Joe, deep down inside, you know, getting being a state representative, it must mean more to you than, you know, a license plate on the back of your car.
Yeah.
Do you really think deep down inside that you can make a difference for Litchfield?
I do, yeah. I think, you know, my interest in just not only, you know, skyrocketing costs for families, but yeah, I do believe. I think we need a representative that's focused on positive change and focused on representing everyone in the community, whether you're a marginalized individual or not. But I don't feel like those marginalized communities in our community are being have a voice right now. And so if I'm that person, I want to be a voice for everybody. And so I think if I can get in there to the state house, and I do believe I can make some impactful changes.
Great. All right. We're going to take another commercial break, and then Joe's going to talk to you. He's going to say a few words to you, and we're going to do that right after this. So stay with us.
Welcome to Staying Safe on Halloween, a low-budget PSA on Halloween safety. Make sure to look both ways before you cross the street, and if you're walking up a road, make sure to use the sidewalk if there's one available. Make sure to check all your candy before eating it. People can hide drugs, razors, or even firearms inside. If you follow these tips, your chances of making it home on Halloween will be greatly improved.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back to In Litchfield. I'm your host, John Latches. See, I trained him right now. He's starting to wave.
I'm learning.
All right. Okay. All right. All right, Joe, we're going to give you, you know, the time that you want to talk to the voters of Litchfield. So I'll give the stage to you.
Sounds good.
Well, go ahead.
Yeah. Well, thank you, John, for having me and holding this interview. Yeah, I just want to say to everyone in Litchfield that thank you for everyone who's been so receptive of my campaign. I'm really trying to make this as positive, and I really want to make sure that we send a representative to Concord that's running on practical ideas. And I do believe that a lot of the things in my platform are representative of a vast majority of people across New Hampshire and in Litchfield. So I'll just say, you know, in the coming weeks, like I mentioned earlier, I'll be canvassing a lot and going door to door. So if I, you know, if I come up to your house, I would love to introduce myself and share a little bit about why I'm running. If you want to learn more about my campaign, we covered a lot today, but if you want to learn more, it's pretty much everything that we addressed today is on there, but you can again visit nhrepjoe.com, and on there you can find my email, you can find a contact form. So if you have any questions or if you want me to make a stop at your house to discuss things, please don't hesitate to reach out and handle all that. And of course, I just want to say again how important it is when we go to the polls on November 8th to vote for candidates who will protect individual human rights and individual rights and freedoms. And I believe that's very important now more than ever. So please consider that when you go to the polls.
Thank you so much, Joe, for coming on. I appreciate it. Best
Thank
of luck
you.
To you.
Thank you so
All
much.
Right. Okay. I'm your host, John Latcher, and that's in Litchfield. We'll see you next time, everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye.
The preceding program was provided by an independent producer solely responsible for its content. The opinions expressed do not necessarily represent the views of this station, its staff, board of directors, or underwriters.